नमस्कार। अ वेरी गुड सैटरडे मॉर्निंग टू ऑल द लर्नर्ड जुडिशियल मेंबर्स अक्रॉस पंजाब एंड हरियाणा एंड यूपी। ऑन बिहाफ ऑफ चंडीगढ़ जुडिशियल एकेडमी, आई हर्षाली चौधरी, फैकल्टी मेंबर चंडीगढ़ जुडिशियल एकेडमी कम एडिशनल डिस्ट्रिक्ट एंड सेशंस जज, वेलकम यू ऑल। एज वी आर अवेयर दैट टुडेज वेबिनार इज बेस्ड ऑन द राइट ऑफ फेयर ट्रायल ऑफ द अक्यूज्ड इन द एरा ऑफ वर्चुअल कोर्ट्स। As we all know that with the pandemic last year, we all heavily got dependent on the usage of video conferencing facilities so far urgent matters or any other court proceedings were concerned. No doubt that we faced many challenges, but also it gave us the opportunity to work upon a new platform for court proceedings. To elaborate on the aspect and future prospects of virtual court vis-a-vis digitization, computerization, video conferencing, and not forgetting the right of the accused to fair trial, especially in the proceedings, I would like to welcome today speaker Shri Pramod Goyal, Member Secretary, Haryana State Legal Services Authority, and District and Sessions Judge. Sir practiced as advocate for 19 years. He also remained as Deputy Advocate General for Union of India. Sir also taught for 4 years in Punjab University. A well-known face in the judiciary, Sir joined Haryana Superior Judicial Services in the year 2008, having been posted at Faridabad as his first place of posting. I had the opportunity to work with Sir and connected with and to get connected with him in the year 2013 when I was posted as Chief Judicial Magistrate Legal Services Authority at Sonipat. In the year 2014, Sir became Central Project Coordinator for Punjab and Haryana and UT at our Punjab and Haryana High Court, thereby looking after the computerization and digitization across the states and also taking forward the vision of E-Committee Supreme Court of India. In the year 2015, Sir became District and Sessions Judge and soon found his way to command Hisar Sessions Division as District and Sessions Judge. Since the year 2019, Sir has been working fervently on the vision of access to justice for all, being Member Secretary, Haryana State Legal Services Authority. In my association with Sir as Master Trainer, I found Sir having the motive to adopt the technology at its best and optimum usage for the betterment of the institution. Sir was pioneer in framing standard operating procedures for video conferencing in the year 2013. And now he would be the ideal person to throw light on these necessary aspect of right of fair trial vis-a-vis virtual courts. I shall be the moderator for this webinar. As we all know that the chat box is open, and once the sir is done with his detailing, we shall be taking up the question and answer sessions. So without further ado, I invite sir to take forward the session. Sir.
A very good morning to all my brother and sister judicial officers. Before we start, we talk about video conferencing. I'd like to share a video clip with you. This video clip is as regards to how technology is changing our lives. I'll request the moderator, my friend, colleague, Mr. Suminder, to kindly show the video.
चलो कर लो
I think there's some technical issues with the video. But I wanted to show this video to emphasize the importance of technology and how fast our lives are changing. I'll just refer to few of the facts which are shown in the video. One of the facts is that in 2013, Google searches were around 2.7 billion in a year. And today it is about 37 billion. That means 100 crore searches are being made on Google every day. Just imagine the use of technology in our day-to-day lives. Similarly, we are all aware about the usage of WhatsApp, other social media tools like Facebook, Twitter. Trending on Twitter has become a new status symbol. It is now better than a page 3 publication in a newspaper. The technology is changing us very fast. In 5,000 years, the amount of data the humankind has generated is being generated in 1 year. Just imagine that whatever knowledge or data we had collected in last 5,000 years is being collected now in just 1 year. These facts are really, in fact, shows that technology is overtaking us. It will be new thing. We'll have to live with the technology. The question is whether the courts are ready with the technology, whether courts are ready to adopt the technology, whether we have been successful in adopting the technology. The answer is to some extent yes and to some extent no. Technology is being adopted by courts for the last about, you can say, 15 to 16 years. Right from 2005 onwards, there is an effort to adopt technology in the courts. One of the technologies which court has adopted successfully, I will say, at least in Punjab and Haryana, is video conferencing. Now the question is, what is video conferencing? Video conferencing is basically, I'll just show share the PPT with you. It has started. I hope you are able to see the PPT. Now the what is video conferencing? Now, video conferencing is live video-based meeting between two or more people at different locations. It is an alternative to physical presence. Basically, it is a platform where people can meet, talk, see each other, even text each other while talking in real time. What are the advantages of video conferencing? As we all know, it saves time. It is very cost effective. I can share one of the instances where we were able to succeed in getting video conferencing to the courts, to each courtroom, by showing its cost effectiveness. I still remember that in 2013, a proposal was sent by High Court regarding video conferencing equipment for each court. That proposal was costing 24 crores for entire Punjab, Haryana and Chandigarh. All the district courts were to be covered under that proposal. However, that proposal was not accepted by the state governments. It remained pending with the state governments. The Honorable High Court took the matter with the state governments. A cost benefit analysis was made. And during making of that cost benefit analysis, it was found out that each doctor which is being examined and is being summoned from PGI Chandigarh or PGI Rohtak is costing PGI at least 11,000 rupees per visit. It included traveler expenses, daily allowances, the salary, working hours lost. So each one of them was costing 11,000 rupees per visit, per video, per evidence recorded by the court. And about 2,000 such doctors were being examined. Now, you kindly note, it is not the cost only. It is the man hours. That means 2,000 man hours of doctors were being lost in recording of evidence, just because they were required to be present at the time of recording of their evidence at the court premises. Therefore, when the cost analysis was made, it was found that not only huge expenses are being borne to examine the doctors, but also for producing the jail inmates who are either facing trial or who are at remand stage. It was found that about 900 to 1,000 rupees were being spent on each production, on each accused for producing him before the court. So we calculated about 1,50,000, 1,90,000 under trials, accused persons were being produced before the courts on daily basis in a year. So when we calculated the cost, it was found that per year, about 12 crore rupees were being spent by state. And with availability of video conferencing soft options, the actual cost of video conferencing also reduced. The entire cost came to be about, as I remember, was about 9 crore rupees only. And we were able to save about 12 crores per year. And I'm talking about 9 crores spending, the amount of rupees 9 crores was being spent for 5 years, because all the equipment of video conferencing, the servers, the software of video conferencing, which all of you know that we are using a video software, these all were fully supported by comprehensive warranty for 5 years. So 5 years after spending this amount, no amount was to be spent on the maintenance of this whole system. And in 5 years, as per the cost estimates, we have already recovered more than 60 crores. So you can see the benefit of effectiveness, cost effectiveness of video conferencing. Then it reduces a lot of practical hassles of traveling. It is easy to connect. It improves communication. It is more engaging than audio conferencing. It increases efficiency, productivity, make all the distances irrelevant. These issues we are well aware about. We are all well aware about the benefits of video conferencing system. What are the key points of video conferencing? As we know that it is a real-time face-to-face meeting. It can be used for not only for meetings, for training sessions, for interviews. Many of us have faced interviews for promotions with Honorable High Court through the facility of video conferencing. Then video conferencing also can be used in day-to-day court proceedings. It has given huge boost to the entire system, entire working, especially during COVID-19 pandemic. In fact, if court could deliver something during this pandemic for last 1.5 years, it was only because we were ready with video conferencing solution, at least in state of Punjab, Haryana and Chandigarh. You know, but these has also got some negative points, such as stability, quality of video conferencing, which fluctuates depending on the bandwidth available at the court site as well as at the remote site. All these are small problems. These are practical problems, but it has got more advantages than disadvantages. Purpose of framing video conferencing rules. Do we require video conferencing rules? The answer is yes. Why it is required? To know why it is required, we'll have to go in the history of video conferencing, how video conferencing has started in the judicial system, in the courts. The video conferencing in Indian courts has evolved through judicial precedent. Honorable Supreme Court in state of Maharashtra versus Praful Desai, 2003, volume 4, SEC 601, had held that evidence includes electronic evidence and video conferencing can be resorted to record evidence of a witness. It was held that recording of such evidence would be as per. It was held that recording of such evidence would be as per procedure established by law. The decision of Honorable Supreme Court had opened the gates of use of video conferencing in Indian courts. Thereafter, various high courts have passed directions to regulate video conferencing, upholding use of video conferencing in court proceedings. Few of the landmark judgments I'll share with you. I am only taking their titles to make it short. The principal judgment is Maharashtra, state of Maharashtra versus Praful Desai. Then judgment of Calcutta High Court, Amitabh Bagchi versus Anna Bagchi. Then Milano Impacts Private Limited versus Eagle Footwear Private Limited. 20th Century Fox Films versus NI Film Production. Mrs. Gurnam Kaur versus Pritam Singh Bhatia. Abhijit Singh alias Ankur Liquor versus State of Punjab. This is a judgment by our High Court. V.K. Shashikala versus Chief Enforcement Officer. Again, is a judgment where use of video conferencing has been accepted and has been regulated by various high courts, including our own Honorable High Court. If you go through the history of video conferencing, you'll find that actually it all started in 2004 when Justice R.C. Lahoti, the then Chief Justice of India, proposed formation of e-committee in 2004. In pursuance of its recommendations, in 2005, National Policy and Action Plan was submitted by e-court, e-committee, which was accepted. In 2006, amendments in CRPC were proposed to introduce video conferencing. However, these amendments remained pending for more than 2 years. In 2007, e-court phase one started. In 2008, amendments to CRPC were notified. And now we are in second phase of e-courts project, which was launched in 2015. By amendment in 2008, proviso were added to section 161, 164, and section 167, as well as section 275. It permitted allowing of recording of statement during investigation, statement of witnesses during investigation, recording of confessional statements, recording of evidence in the courts by virtue of amendment in section 275 CRPC, as well as allowing remand of accused persons under section 167. Similar to these provisions, amendment or provisions regarding video conferencing were also introduced in the Protection of Children from Sexual Offences, POCSO Act 2012. It allowed audio-video means for recording statement of minor at the stage of investigation. It also protected the identity of minor while recording the evidence of minor at the time of trial. In many courts, I have seen one such special provision in the court at Chandigarh, where the minor, the witness is examined without coming in physical contact of the accused. Though accused can hear her, but the minor is examined in a friendly atmosphere environment without exposing her to the glares of accused, ensuring her safety as well as well-being. The question is whether video conferencing is creating any difficulties to enforce the rights which have been granted by Constitution as well as other laws to an accused person. Today's webinar has been organized basically to understand how video conferencing works and what are the advantages, what are the disadvantages, and how these disadvantages are to be overcome by the courts. We all know the advantages we had discussed. It is cost effective, it is fast, it is convenient, everything, all those things are there. But whether it is creating a cloud over the rights of accused persons, especially when first remand is given, when their statement under Section 313 is being recorded through video conferencing, or when confessional statement under Section 164 CRPC is recorded through video conferencing. These are the issues which we need to discuss and understand. The question is how the video conferencing is being done. Are we following right procedure? Is there any rules of video conferencing? To my mind, video conferencing rules are being framed right from 2013 by our High Court, either on administrative side or through judicial pronouncements. They have also evolved from time to time. I'm not talking about all the previous rules. I will only refer to two rules which are now prevalent, which are basically being under implementation by the courts. In 2018, the Honorable Punjab and Haryana High Court circulated guidelines as to how video conferencing is to be conducted. These guidelines were circulated not only amongst the judicial officers, but also with court staff, jails, observation homes, children homes, hospitals, as well as members of bars. Now, subsequent to these guidelines, in 2020, white letter dated 21st of May 2020, High Court, Honorable High Court has circulated model rules on video conferencing as received from Honorable Supreme Court of India. These rules are known as video conferencing rules, or you can say these are known as model video conferencing rules. Honorable Supreme Court has left to the High Courts to adopt these rules. What are these rules? What is the benefit of these rules? These rules basically institutionalize video conferencing concept as well as the principle of fair trials as part of our procedure. So before we proceed further and conclude what is the difference between 2018 guidelines issued by Honorable High Court and the model video conferencing rules circulated in 2020. Let us see how video conferencing needs to be conducted under the model video conferencing rules first. Then we'll come to the difference, if any, with the guidelines issued by Honorable High Court in 2018. I'll request the technical staff to run the PPT. In these model rules, there are few definitions given by the Honorable Supreme Court. I will not cover all of them. I'll only go through the important ones. One term is commissioner. Who is commissioner? Commissioner is a person who is appointed under the provisions of CPC or CRPC. It includes commissioner who is appointed for recording evidence. Another term is court users. Who is court user? It means any person that is, it can be magistrate who is using video conferencing, it can be ADJ, it can be district judge who is using video conferencing at court point. What is live link? Now, generally, we are habitual of video conferencing. That means we speak, listen to each other, talk to each other. But sometimes presence alone is cured. The facility of talking to each other is not available. This is done sometimes through television link. So live link in these model rules includes live television link by audio, video, electronic means or other arrangement. It includes television link, thereby clearly showing the intention that video conferencing is not just once a two way, it can be one way. Only we can think, we can hear, we can talk, we can by way of short VC, by way of television link or any other other arrangement. That means because technology is changing very fast. I'll just give an example of change in technology. How many of you are aware of 2014 election campaign run by Prime Minister Narendra Modi? He came up with a unique idea of holographic election rallies. It was a 3D projection of image of a person at the local site. It appeared that as if the person is present at the local site by creating his 3D image through holographic technology. So technologies, though it is not being used throughout the spectrum because of cost restraints, but you know that initial technology is always costly. With increased usage and technological successes or technological breakthroughs, the technology gets cheaper day by day. So live link includes all such arrangements which may come in future, which we are not even aware as on today. Then another term which requires carefully, needs to be noted carefully, is remote user. Who is remote user? Anybody who is not in the court proceedings, who is not holding from court point, is a remote user. He can be a prisoner who is lodged at jail. He can be a witness, a doctor from hospital. He can be a person who is giving his evidence from another video conferencing facility available in another district. Therefore, remote user is anybody who is away from the court. The next term which requires to be discussed is required persons. Who is required person? Again, any person whose presence is required in the court proceedings will be termed required person. He can be a witness. He can be a person whose presence is required in the proceedings. It can be an accused. It can be an advocate of any of the parties, or it can be any person who is required by the court in the conduct of court proceedings before it. Therefore, required person is person required in the court proceedings. What are the general principles of video conferencing? Now, first foremost question which arises in our mind is, what are the stages of judicial proceedings where video conferencing can be utilized? Now, as per modern rules, all stages of judicial proceedings, both in civil and criminal cases, video conferencing can be used, utilized, and presence of required persons can be secured through video conferencing. Now, what are the protocols? Is there any difference between physical court or virtual proceedings? Again, the answer is no, there is no difference. Virtual proceedings are only mirror proceedings of physical courts, or it is an alternative to physical courts. So all the laws, all the statutory provisions as are applicable in physical proceedings shall be applicable to virtual proceedings also. The provisions of CPC, CRPC, IT Act, etc. shall also apply to these particular proceedings. No, it is not something new. It is only an alternative to physical courts. Then whether VC rules would apply to commissioner who are entrusted to record evidence by the court? The answer is yes. They shall apply not only to commissioner, but also to inquiry officer if some inquiry officer is appointed by the courts. Then whether it is required to establish the identity of person who is to be examined, whose presence is required to be secured through video conferencing? The answer is yes. It is utmost important to ensure the ID proof of such person. Any ID proof which is authorized by government, such as voter card, Aadhaar card, driving license, can be used to establish the identity of required person. And in case the identity card is not forthcoming, then what should court do? The simple is, you record the name, parentage, permanent and temporary address, and you can insist on seeking the affidavit duly attested by authorities under the provisions of CPC and CRPC. What are the requirements for VC? We all know very well. We have been using VC for the last 5 years. I think every officer who is working in the court is well aware about it. I'll just make a fast reference to all the equipment required: desktop with printer, desktop or a computer, which can include any mobile, any device which has got internet connectivity and can be connected with the printer. Uninterrupted power supply, camera, microphone, speaker, display unit, so that other than person being shown on video conferencing, is the other person present in the court can see the court proceedings. Document visualizer to share the document with others. Provision of a firewall. Now, this is to be taken care by the technical team of Honorable High Court. This is not to be seen by a judicial officer or individual courts. Then advocate sitting arrangements. There should be quiet surroundings, and proper lighting is available for conducting video conferencing. These you can summarize, you can graphically depict all the requirements as I have shown in this slide. Now, what are the arrangements to be made? Appointment of coordinator at court point as well as remote point. Now, who is a coordinator? I purposely skipped the term coordinator at the time we discussed various terms. What is the importance of coordinator? Is he required? What is his role? And can he be instrumental in successful or failure rate of a video conferencing in a court proceedings? The answer is that coordinator is one of the most important person who coordinates video conferencing and ensure its success. Now, who is coordinator? Coordinator is a person appointed by court or authority designated at remote point who shall coordinate to hold the video conferencing. Therefore, coordinator is required to be appointed both at court point as well as remote point. However, there is an exception to this appointment of coordinated at remote point. What is that exception? The exception is that when argument is to be made by advocate, then there is no requirement of appointment of coordinator at the remote point. When the presence of witnesses, presence of parties is not required, only the arguments are to be raised by advocates, then coordinator presence or his appointment can be dispensed with. Now, the another question which may arise in your minds that VC facilities are not available at many places. Now, what to do? The answer is very simple. In almost all the courts, VC facilities are available. Request can be made to nearby court to make provision for person to come present and appear before the court from a remote site. So court facility at one station is not only available for the cases which are pending in that court premises. It is also available to all in all court proceedings throughout. The another requirement or preparation is issuance of notice in advance. Nobody can appear if he has got no information. So notice or issuance of summons is mandatory. And therefore, the notice must contain clearly when to appear, where to appear, time, date, as well as it should also accompany the documents or record which are required to be shared at the time of recording of evidence. The another requirement which is mandatory, or you can say must at the time of preparation itself, is apart from appointment of coordinator, in case a person or an accused is not well conversant with the court language, then we need to provide interpreter or translator. An expert of sign language is required in case the person is deaf and dumb. Similarly, an interpreter or a special educator is required with person having any physical or mental disability. Now, next question would be, who can appoint coordinator? In case remote point is overseas, then Indian consulate or Indian embassy or Indian High Commission of India can appoint a coordinator. If court is in another state, authorized officer nominated by district judge. If the remote site, remote point is at mediation center or DLSA, then any person authorized or nominated by chairman, secretary, DLSA. In case of jail, it is jail superintendents. It is or his nominee. In case of hospital, it is medical superintendent or his nominee. In case of CCI, women rescue homes, the superintendent or its office in charge or his nominee. In case of forensic science lab, it is authorized administrative officer in charge or his nominee. So, as well as coordinators are used, are concerned, their appointment is well regulated under these rules, because it is for the reason that the role of coordinator is very important. It is these coordinators who ensure VC is conducted correctly, are of good quality, and are conducted in time. Then what is the role of coordinator? He has to ensure that the required person, now required person can be a witness, he can be an accused person or any person required by the court, to be available at remote site at least 30 minutes before the scheduled time. He must ensure that there is no unauthorized recording or device is being used at the remote site. It is he who has to ensure that no unauthorized person enters remote location at the time of VC. He has to ensure that the person who is being examined is not prompted, tutored, coaxed or induced or coerced in any manner. He shall ensure that coordinator at remote point receives all relevant documents before start of VC. So you can see the importance of remote point coordinator. It is actually the pointsman who is supposed to carry out directions of the court to ensure that VC is successful and is fruitful. Now, what is the procedure for video conferencing? We know we have got the equipment, we have got the coordinator. We know what is the who has to appoint the coordinator and what is the role of coordinator. Now, what is the procedure for video conferencing? Now, while talking about procedure of for video conferencing, I'll also request all of you to just refresh yourself as to what is fair trial. What do you mean by fair trial principles? Whether fair trial principles are required, whether they need to be included in procedure for VC, and whether they have actually been included in the procedure for VC in the model rules. These are three questions we have to answer at the end of this, at the end of discussion on model rules. Now, what is the procedure? Simple. As we all know that anybody, the parties, even court of its own, can decide to hold proceeding through video conferencing. In case a request is made by any party or a witness for video conferencing, the court should generally put the request of video conferencing, share the same with both the sides, and discuss the same with it. And after hearing both the sides, the court can pass appropriate order and fix the schedule of VC. Any case, oral submission are made through VC. In said case, written arguments in advance through official mail ID of the court may be asked from the advocate, concerned advocate. Thereafter, once a date is fixed, summons are to be issued. So summons have to be issued in accordance with provisions of CPC and CRPC as applicable to services of summons. Date, time, venue of remote point has to be mentioned. The party has to be informed. The person required to be present has to be informed. that he must carry his ID proof or an affidavit to verify his ID. Then next issue is examination. How examination is to be conducted? First of all, the court is duty bound to identify the person and find out that the person being sought to be examined is the person who is present at the remote point. This has to be done through proof of identity issued by a government or by way of affidavit, as we had discussed earlier. When should a witness be examined? He should be examined preferably ordinarily in court working hours. It is only in exception circumstances, for the reasons recorded in orders, court should fix date time for VC beyond court times or before court times, especially in case of overseas evidence or overseas presence of witnesses or parties. Thereafter, oath has to be administered in presence of court by the coordinator. Kindly note that oath has to be administered to the witness in presence of the court, not before or after court is available through VC. Then court has to allow under trials to consult their counsels before, during and after VC to instruct them. The documents must be transmitted, must be available to the witness, which are being referred during examination or presence of witness or a person, required person, at the time of video conferencing at the remote point. Now, I'll also like to inform you that if somebody wants to be present at the remote site at the time of examination of a person, required person, she should be allowed at his own cost. I'll just give example. There are two parties, party A and party B. Party B wants to examine a witness whose case is at Chandigarh, whereas witness is residing in Kolkata. And the application of party B is permitted by the court for examination of his witness through video conferencing. Now, if party A wants to ensure that his counsel or any other authorized person is available, is remain present at the remote site in Calcutta during examination of said witness of party B, then such permission should be allowed generally, and the party A should be allowed to be present at the time of examination at remote site also, but at his own expenses. Then we have already discussed that witnesses must be supplied with copies. Procedure of VC again has to be the same as we are habitual of conducting physical examination. As in case of physical examination, court are at liberty to record demeanor of a person at the time of evidence, recording of evidence. Now, it is very important that when video conferencing is being conducted, the court must ensure that court is able to see the accused person fully or is able to see the witness fully and should be in control of remote camera so that surroundings can also be noticed by the court if so desired or required by the court. Then objection if raised during the deposition of a person, they must be recorded by the court. The main point which all of us had a lot of confusion earlier, now there is no confusion, is how to get the signatures of a witness from a remote site, who is present at the remote site. Now the model rules has clarified everything, how it is to be done. The moment evidence is recorded by the court, the transcription has to be noted. It has to be, a soft copy is to be shared, which cannot be edited is to be shared with the remote site coordinator after digitally signing it. All the judicial officers in state of Punjab, Haryana and Chandigarh have got their independent digital signatures with them. Therefore, there is no difficulty in this regard. Once the soft copy is received by coordinator, a printout of digitally signed transcription has to be taken by him. The same has to be signed by him and by the witness after reading the same. So procedure more or less is similar to physical proceedings. The only difference is as regards to practical aspects because of distance at the time of video conferencing. And thereafter, the same transcription which has been signed by the witness or person present, that needs to be shared by coordinator from of remote site with the coordinator of court site after digitally signing the same. After digital signatures and sending the same to the court, the physical copy is also required to be sent within 3 days, either by speed post or by courier, certified courier or approved courier to the court concerned. Now, it is also necessary that no recording, unless permitted by the court, should be done of evidence or the court proceedings. Similarly, no unauthorized person shall remain present at the remote site except the person examined, or in case some person is required to be present, the court permission should be taken in advance. Then again, it is a discretion of the court to grant adjournments or not to grant adjournment. Depending on facts and circumstances of each case, court can proceed. Even in case of VC, an adjournment can be granted, but for the reasons which justifies the adjournment. Then there can be cases where a person is unable to come to the court physically, or he is not in a position even to visit remote site near his house, that is court near his house, for video conferencing. In such cases, portable VC systems can be arranged to record evidence or presence of sick or physically infirm person. So this is all, the entire thing is similar to court physical proceedings. The only safeguards are required to be placed and they are required to be ensured. Then again, one question is how to get signatures of person who is at remote site. The another question is how to exhibit documents from remote site. So as we are all aware that it is duty to share the documents with the remote coordinator so that he is able to make them available to the witness or the accused at remote site. These documents can be transmitted electronically through email, or advanced hard copy can also be dispatched through physical means. Apart from these procedural aspects, there are other practical aspects which coordinator is required to see through and ensure that such as that all the technical requirements for a VC are in accordance with prescribed norms, that technical requirements at both court and remote site are complied with. Coordinator at court point shall remain in contact with advocates and other coordinator for successful VC. Any problem has to be resolved by the court point coordinator as far as technical concerns. It is also duty of remote coordinator to inform court coordinator or the court regarding any defect during the proceedings in video or audio feed. If the video conferencing during this period is not in accordance with system, in accordance with the quality, prescribed quality, where a person is able to see clearly and able to hear and speak clearly, this has to be reported immediately by remote coordinator as well as court coordinator to the court, so that ample precautions are taken and no prejudice is caused to any party. Ensuring seamless video conferencing, I have covered and discussed with you just now. Court has to mention in order sheet time and duration of proceedings, software used, documents which were transmitted online, mentioning of duration of digital recording. All these things are to be recorded by the court to ensure that any query, if raised in future, is well documented and answered in those documents. Now, the question which is of utmost importance is as regards to confessional statements as well as regards to first remand. Now, I'd like to point out the difference between model rules prescribed by Supreme Court and guidelines issued by Honorable High Court in 2018. There is only one difference between these rules. The rest of the things are almost and in all senses one and same. Remote coordinator, duties of coordinator, how VC is to be conducted, all these things are absolutely same in both set of rules, that is in 2018 rules as well as in 2020 rules framed by Honorable Supreme Court. The only difference is as regards to confessional statement, recording of confessional statements under section 164 of CRPC. Under 2018 rules, confessional statements under section 164 CRPC cannot be recorded through video conferencing, whereas in model rules framed by Honorable Supreme Court, it has been permitted, however, in extraordinary circumstances after recording the reasons. So this is the only difference between these two types of guidelines and rules. As far as this contradiction is concerned, this contradiction can only be clarified by the Honorable High Court. We'll have to wait for clarification in this regard. Now, it is therefore, while recording VC, especially at the time of first remand, at the time of framing of charges, examination of accused and proceeding under section 164 of CRPC. Utmost importance to the principles of fair trial have to be given. It is the fair trial principles which have to be taken care while recording these statements. Though fair trial principles are applicable to all the video conferencings proceedings, but in these proceedings where remand is to be given through video conferencing, where confessional statements is to be recorded under section 164, or where witnesses to be examined, or where charges to be framed, where a statement under section 313 CRPC is to be recorded, it is the duty of the court to ensure fair trial principles. Another principle which requires to be kept in mind is that video conferencing should be done through the video conferencing software which is designated by court. Why it is so required? It is so required to stop hacking. It is so required to ensure unauthorized copy of unauthorized recording of such proceedings by persons not desired. Therefore, all these things have to be kept in mind while doing these video conferencing proceedings. As I have already discussed, that all these identity of person, time of video recording, they have to be taken care of. Then there is a provision to pay honorarium to coordinator that can be paid in consultation with parties, concerned parties. Generally, no honorarium is paid where parties are already in government employment or institutional employment, but it is a discretion of the court to pay honorarium in consultation with the parties. Now, who is to bear the cost of video conferencing? The cost of video conferencing in criminal cases is to be borne by such party as directed by the court. Now, how it is to be determined which party has to pay it? The reference has to be made to Punjab and Haryana High Court rules and orders, Part 3, Chapter 9, Part A can be referred. And accordingly, the cost can be fixed on a particular party as regards to video conferencing. In civil matters, the person who makes the request has to bear the expenses. The court can consider payment of expenses to complainant and witnesses as may be prevalent from time to time. And court has also power to waive off the costs as warranted in a given situation. So it is complete discretion of each one of us to regulate the cost factor of a video conferencing. Now, next question. We have come to know how video conferencing is conducted. The two most important questions which are left to be considered are conduct of proceedings and conduct of persons present in the proceedings, and whether these proceedings can be allowed to be viewed by all or can be restricted and has to be restricted only for those persons who are party to the suit. In India, most of the court proceedings are open court proceedings. Therefore, the person who wants to watch court proceedings should be generally allowed to watch those court proceedings and can be connected to video conferencing by making appropriate provision so that he is not able to interfere in the actual conduct of video conferencing. However, in case where camera proceedings are mandated, in such like cases, no unauthorized person, no public viewing can be allowed. The provisions of law have to be accepted and implemented in those cases. Open court hearing is not available in such like cases. And therefore, in case of video conferencing also, similar thing has to be done. In open court will not be available in camera proceedings. Now, party should be informed well in advance that they should be well dressed. They have to maintain decorum of the court. Actually, virtual court proceedings are only the extension of physical court proceedings. Therefore, you kindly ensure the same decorum as is expected in a physical proceeding. There is no difference between virtual and physical. Same conduct or ethics would be applicable in conduct of proceedings through virtual means or through video conferencing. Then, since I am in Halsa, it is my duty to inform all the judicial officers that DLSs have got video conferencing facilities in state of Haryana. Those facilities in appropriate cases can be used by the court. Legal service authorities can be requested for providing remote point if needed for holding court proceedings. And those facilities can be used by courts by requesting to the relevant chairman / secretary of DLSA. Now, question is, the question is that whether fair trial principles are being violated by video conferencing. The question, as an important question which requires to be answered, is whether fair trial principles are required to be implemented while conducting court proceedings through video conferencing. The answer is yes. There can be no exception. The rights of parties given to them by virtue of Constitution of India or virtue of enactment by Parliament or state legislature cannot be taken away only because the proceedings are being conducted through video conferencing, as it is more convenient to hold proceedings through video conferencing. So all the safeguards available to parties, including accused persons, are available to the parties even in court proceedings through video conferencing. The question would be that whether these fair trial principles have been included in these model rules. The answer is yes. It is the model rules has got sufficient, you can say, it has got sufficient references to provide fair trial principles, to adopt fair trial principles at the time of video conferencing. I'll just give examples to them, examples of them. One is allowing people to attend court proceedings through video conferencing. This is one principle of fair trial. It is equivalent to open court proceedings. Then issuing notices prior to video conferencing. It is similar to physical courts, that is informing the person who is required to be to appear before the court. These are all issues which find mention in the model rules. However, there are few downsides of video conferencing also. We must discuss those also. Some are technical, such as untrained user, bandwidth compulsions, lack of good quality audio video equipments, multiple softwares. Then there are questions being raised regarding impartiality of coordinators, especially in case of police remand or judicial remand. Questions are being raised as regards to appointment of jail superintendent as coordinated, as it may create fear in the mind of accused. Stop. We need to stop here for a moment. The advantage of physical appearance before the court, especially in criminal matters, is a safeguard as to torture, as to coercion, as to force being used by the police. Now, this safeguard is absent in case of video conferencing, and we need to include this safeguard while conducting proceedings through video conferencing. In case of first demand, protection from torture, ability of free speech sometimes is compromised. The practice of allowing the police officers to use their mobile and seek police remand through their mobiles on WhatsApp is not a good practice, needs to be discontinued immediately. As the complete appearance of accused is generally not available in such like calls. Then there are issues regarding confidentiality of communication between advocate and a client. There are issues as regards to chances of opportunity during the course of proceedings to discuss the matter by the client with his advocate. Sometimes the translator or special educator is absent. The effective counsel, effective legal advice is sometimes impaired in video conferencing proceedings. Sometimes if we don't allow open court hearing, even if it is otherwise permissible, even this can cause prejudice to the accused or a person who is using video conferencing or the other party. To my mind, these are all practical difficulties. These are not procedural difficulties. There is no difference of opinion as regards to implementation of fair trial principles during video conferencing. It is well accepted principle that court proceedings, action of court should not cause any prejudice to any party to the litigation. It may be accused, it may be a party or B party in a civil dispute. The court must act impartially without any causing any prejudice to any of the parties to the list. This is a basic principle duty of each and every court. And this basic duty has to be actually fully implemented and ensured by each of us And we don't have any discretion in this. We cannot say that we are not obliged to provide fair trial to an accused just because we opted for speedy trial through video conferencing. Speedy trial, no doubt, is a fundamental right of each accused. But in the name of speedy trial, we cannot cause prejudice to his rights. The rights vested in an accused have to be honored and they have to be implemented by each court. So, as far as courts are concerned, fair trial principles are embedded in their working, whether it is physical working or whether it is a working through video conferencing. So all those issues or disadvantages which I have highlighted earlier needs to be taken care of by the courts while holding the video conferencing. And in case court finds, it is dependent upon fact and circumstances of each case, that any of the rights of the accused or a person facing illness is being compromised or being prejudiced by video conferencing, then court has got clear discretion to opt for physical appearance and physical court proceedings. Video conferencing is an enabling provision and it cannot be used to disable the rights. Rights of the parties must be upheld. There are many suggestions that video conferencing proceedings should be dropped. Only physical court proceedings should be held. With due respect to all those who hold this view, I disagree with them. We cannot control technology. We cannot control the change in our lives. Change would come. Change is basic of nature. Nobody can stop the change. One interesting fact which I like to share with you all of you is that in Europe in 18th and 19th century, horse carts were the main or you can major means of transport. And these horse carts were considered to be major polluter. And when motor cars were introduced for the first time in late 19th or early 20th century, they were taken as substitute of horse carts to avoid pollution. And we all know that motor cars are one of the biggest source of pollution today in our day-to-day life. Human beings have a tendency to resist changes. We are more inclined towards status quo. We want status quo. Each one of us has got some habits. We get disturbed if some diversion is shown or some disturbance is caused in our way of life. One example is because I have remained registered computerization. I know the pearls of trainings which we had conducted to make judicial workforce compliant with Ubuntu. And I tell you, my experience has been that neither Ubuntu nor Windows has got any major role in our working. Both are operating system. Their own role is limited to start the computer and enable the software which we are supposed to use on those computers. If you find softwares available on Microsoft Windows and Ubuntu operating system computers, you'll find that all the softwares are only mirror copies. All the functionalities which are available in Word are available in LibreOffice. There is no difference. Not a single difference is available because I have been using both of them. I'll again share a very interesting fact with all of you that in 1995, when Windows 95 was launched, logo was prepared by Windows, Microsoft. And when that logo played, it had a background music. And that background music of Windows 95 was recorded on a Macintosh computer, that's the Apple computer. It was not recorded, it was not recordable on Windows enabled computer. So you can see that most of the usage is concerned, Ubuntu or Windows has got no concern. But we had faced a lot of difficulties. There was a lot of resistance. The resistance was of mindset. Mindset not to change. Mindset to go by convenience and status quo. Similarly, same is applicable in case of all technologies, including video conferencing. Proceedings, physical proceedings, and video conferencing proceedings cannot be said to be different. They are complementary to each other. All the rights have to be implemented, have to be given to the parties as are available in physical courts. So therefore, I would like to enlist all the steps which we all bound to take when video conferencing proceedings are being held by us. Now, there is a right of all accused persons against arbitrary arrest and ill treatment. So my request would be, if first police remand, when the accused is being produced before the court within 24 hours of his arrest, then it should be done in physical mode, except in extraordinary circumstances, to be recorded by us. And at the time, and in case situation is such, in extraordinary situation as a reason, and video conferencing, accused is being remanded through video conferencing for the first time, in that case, the magistrate is duty bound to check whole body of accused, not just the face. In case of doubt, police be asked to produce accused person in person. And it is preferable that accused be produced from a remote site, which may be prepared in the court to keep the distance, so that accused is not in complete control of the police authorities. Then presence of counsel has to be ensured at the time of remand, because generally we are seeing it on regular basis that counsel is not informed about the date and time and day when the accused would be produced, and therefore he is not able to come before the court. But legal aid counsels, remand counsels are designated for each court. It is our duty, it is duty of magistrates to ensure that those remand counsels are present and all the rights of accused are fully upheld while conducting proceeding through video conferencing. Then accused should also be able to see entire court, including judge, lawyer, witnesses. Quality of video, audio video should be good and working, and the video conferencing should be working throughout. Accused should be produced one by one at the time of remand. Unless they are being tried together. In case five accused are being tried together, they can be produced at one go from the jail. But generally, sufficient time should be taken while giving remand, verifying their identities, asking them about their queries. These should be taken care of. These things are required in case of physical hearing as well as in case of video conferencing. Similarly, right to have effective counsel has to be implemented. At the time of remand, at the time of court proceedings, at the time of recording of evidence, it is the duty of the court to ensure presence of counsel representing accused person. Any case for some reason advocate is not there, in such like cases legal aid counsel should be provided. Accused must be also informed regarding the proceedings held before the court. Most of times we grant a date for next appearance, but accused are not informed about it. It is only known to either the court or to the coordinator at the remote site. This should be avoided. This should be discontinued and ensured that the accused comes to know about the next date fixed by the court for his appearance. Lawyers should be given full opportunity to interact with their counsels, with their clients before the date fixed, during the trial, or even after the trial. Due mechanisms have to be made out. One mechanism is that we can designate a separate video conferencing room where, if need be, if court feels that it is necessary for the lawyer and client to discuss the matter even during the trial, then in that case accused and client should be allowed to interact with each other, and that interaction should be in confidence, because this is a right of accused to avail legal help during the trial, and this right cannot be compromised. Then wherever translator, interpreter, educator, or any other person who needs to be present to cater the needs of special person should be made available. Documents should be made available to the parties beforehand, because all these rights are sacrosanct and must be implemented, ensured, and has to be ensured by the courts alone. Nobody has duty except for the court to ensure that fair trial principles are embedded, implemented, and practiced by us, all of us. So with this, I'll thank all of you for such a patient hearing. I hope that it was not lengthy. Half an hour. I don't think it is very lengthy. And in case you have any questions, you can raise those questions. I'll try to answer those questions with whatever little knowledge I have got. I'll request Harshali to take up all the questions raised by participants. Over to Harshali.
Yes, sir. Thank you very much, sir. And we received a few questions on today's subject. One of the common questions that we received was that during this pandemic time, would, and even otherwise also, whether recording of confession or dying declaration is feasible, and if yes, how about the evidentiary value of that confessional statement or the dying declaration recorded through VC?
The evidentiary value of anything which is recorded through VC is similar as in case of physical proceedings. As I have been discussing with you, that physical discussion, physical court proceedings and proceedings through video conferencing are not different proceedings. Their modes may be different, but their effect is the same. Same principles, same safeguards, which are applicable in case of physical proceedings, are applicable in case of video conferencing proceedings also. So as far as evidentiary value is concerned, unless it is shown that the procedure of video conferencing is not proper, it has caused grave prejudice to the accused person, the evidentiary value of video conferencing is the same as in case of physical proceedings. Now, coming to the second part. What was that second part, Shali?
So one was whether it can be recorded, and other, what is the evidentiary value?
The second part is whether confessional statement and dying declaration can be recorded through video conferencing. Generally, as far as our Honorable High Court is concerned, in 2018, our Honorable High Court had issued guidelines, and as per those guidelines, confessional statement cannot be recorded through video conferencing and it should be recorded only through physical means. However, model rules framed by Honorable Supreme Court permits recording of confessional statement only in extraordinary circumstances to be recorded and allowed by the court. So as on today, we can say that we need a clarification from Honorable High Court as regards to confessional statement in case same are required to be recorded through video conferencing. As far as dying declaration is concerned, again, same principles would be applicable. Dying declaration has to be recorded physically at first instance, preferably at first instance. And in case of extraordinary circumstances, where it is not possible to record for some reasons, for some justified reasons, the dying declaration cannot be recorded physically. In those cases, in exceptional circumstances, dying declaration may be recorded through video conferencing. So video conferencing in dying case of dying declaration, in case of confessional statement, has to be resorted as an exceptional circumstances. First and foremost method is physical proceedings. It is only a, you can say, a short time, a gap arrangement sort of thing in these regards. With advancement in technology, with advancement in video conferencing equipments, softwares, with passage of time, you will find that even confessional statements and dying declaration would be required to be recorded through video conferencing because times are changing. We cannot stop change. Human beings have no capacity to stop the changes which are bound to come with which are forced by nature or which are caused by technology. So we have to be prepared with video conferencing, but again, the emphasis would be fair trial principles. No prejudice should be caused to any person due to the act of court. So it is only in exceptional circumstances these video conferencing in case of confessional statements and dying declaration must be resorted to.
Yes, sir. Sir, another question is with regard to the technical aspect of the video conferencing vis-a-vis the bandwidth or the network issues that we face generally. So it's an observation made by one of the officers that network issue is the biggest challenge which is being faced by us. And how can we overcome it? And if we get high speed network at our end, but still in many cases we see there is no better network on the other side. Even if we ourselves are also facing network issues which hamper the smooth VC proceedings. And along with that, there was another suggestion by one of the officers that, sir, can we propose installation of high speed networks in courts instead of BSNL or Pawan only? For this purpose, there are no clarifications, though we can get any network at our official residence. But so far as courts are concerned, there are no clarifications on this point.
Yes, bandwidth is one of the major problems. It actually hampers the quality as well as efficacy of video conferencing. It is not in doubt. It's a practical problem. Things have changed a lot. I still remember in 1999, when we used to have dial-up internet connections, it used to take 5 minutes to upload a web page. You can have a snack in between the after starting loading the web page, and then enjoy your snack. And then by the time you finish up with your snack, the web page used to upload. The things have changed a lot. As far as bandwidth is concerned, dedicated lines through NIC as well as from Hotron have been made available. And in all courts, broadband connections have also been provided. Policy decisions are to be made by Honorable Computer Committee, Honorable High Court. And as far as I remember, way back in 2014, there was a request from one officer from Jalandhar, I hope it was Jalandhar, who made a request that BSNL connection provided at his residence is not working properly. We had placed that matter before the Honorable Computer Committee, and Honorable Computer Committee was kind enough to allow judicial officers to opt for any service provider after fixing the upper limit for the connection. The upper limit is, I think, 1425 rupees per month. That is the upper limit available for a judicial officer to avail a broadband connection at his home office. So similarly, these are all practical issues. I'll request learned district and session judges to kindly take up this matter, make a research which service provider in your area, because you see, all the service providers are not able to provide good bandwidth at all places in a particular city. I know that in one sector in Chandigarh, BSNL is providing good services. In another sector, the services of BSNL are absolutely useless. But Airtel is providing good services. So you need to verify and find out which service provider in your area where courts are situated is providing good bandwidth. And you can make a request to the Honorable High Court. Honorable High Court has never said no to any of the infrastructural issues being faced by the courts. I can say that Punjab, Haryana, and Chandigarh have got the best infrastructure in the courts throughout India. Our infrastructure is not comparable with any other state in India as far as computerization is concerned. We have got very good infrastructure, and it needs to be supported, or you can say augmented, every time. It is service providers cannot be taken for granted for all times. Their service keep on changing. Today BSNL is providing good service at a particular place. It may not provide good services after 6 months. So you have to keep asking your service provider to provide services as promised by him, and to shift to new service provider in case one is not providing good services or bandwidth. Bandwidth now can also be ensured by ensuring proper usage, and also arranging court times, video conferencing times between the courts accordingly as per the availability of bandwidth. You see, if your bandwidth is 8 Mbps and at that time 20 courts are trying to conduct video conferencing, you will face difficulty. If your bandwidth is 8 Mbps and only 6 courts are using video conferencing facility, the quality of video conferencing will improve. So video conferencing bandwidth is also dependent upon number of users. So you need to also take in consideration all these facts and use optimum bandwidth for video conferencing.
Yes, sir. So another interesting and the practical issue that we also face in the courts is that asked by another judicial officer is that in any particular jail, there is only a single VC system, whereas the number of accused persons to be produced in every court is much larger. And thus it is very difficult to record the evidence in the presence of the accused in the trials. So what can be suggested on that?
Again, this is a practical problem. As far as I remember, each jail has got 2 to 3 video conferencing equipments, one provided by High Court, one purchased by jail authorities, and in few jails, almost in Haryana, I know, out of 19, 16 jails, E committee has also provided VC equipments. VC equipment today is not an issue. Issue is bandwidth. If the jail authorities have got the bandwidth, you can suggest them that any VC, any computer with Logitech camera or inbuilt mic and speaker can be used for video conferencing. Because what we are using right now is soft VC option and not the hard VC option. Earlier, from 2011 to 2014, we had been using hard VC points, which were difficult to connect and had their own limitations. But after 2014, we have already shifted to soft video conferencing options. And these soft video conferencing options are basically platform neutral. You can use them with dedicated video conferencing cameras. You can use them with inbuilt video cameras in a desktop, all in one. All in one are being used in the courts in the state of Punjab and Haryana and Chandigarh. They are all capable individually of doing video conferencing without there being a need of camera, mic, speaker separately, though it has been given separately to each court. But our video conferencing, our computers are also compliant with video conferencing for limited video conferencing. They have limitations, but they can be used. Similarly, we can ask the jail authorities. We can raise this matter with Honorable High Court. And if we raise this matter with Honorable High Court regarding non-availability of infrastructure with the jail authorities, then I'm sure that it will be looked into and it will be rectified quickly.
Yes, sir. Sir, we are getting number of questions and I think with the paucity of time, we won't be able to take a lot of them. But let's see, sir, a couple of more questions that we can take. Is that, sir, if Defence Counsel objects to recording of evidence when accused is produced through VC, especially during these COVID times, can we force accused counsel to examine the witness, although accused is not present in person but through VC?
Presence of accused can be recorded through VC. There is no problem. But we have to ensure that fair trial principles are applicable. All the safeguards, all the rights available to that accused are provided to him at the time of recording of evidence through video conferencing. As far as model rules are concerned or 2018 guidelines are concerned, there is no bar. Presence of an accused can be secured through video conferencing for recording the evidence. The only issue is as regards to his rights, whether his rights are being kept in mind, they are being provided, the accused is being provided with all the safeguards which he is entitled to, and whether any prejudice is caused to his defenses. He must have access to the documents. He must have access to his counsel. He must have right to consult his counsel during the trial. And that communication between him and his counsel has to be confidential. All these things have to be ensured at the time of recording of evidence by securing presence of an accused by remote means. Even in case of 313 CRPC statement, these principles have to be adopted and has to be, and a statement of a accused can be recorded under section 313 through video conferencing. Actually, sometimes it is required also. I myself has experience of one such case. At Sonipat, a person had killed another person in the court premises. He was immediately arrested immediately after the occurrence. The man who was fired upon was killed. That trial was held by me. Actually, there was two gangs. It was a gang war between two gangs. And the person who was facing trial before my court was facing threat from the rival gang, which was lodged in Sonipat jail. A request was made by that accused person as well as police authorities that he be lodged during trial at Rohtak rather than at Sonipat, which was allowed. His trial was held from Rohtak. He was summoned and presented before the court from Rohtak jail. However, at the time of recording of statement under section 313 CRPC, police had produced an intelligence report stating that if this accused is produced before the Sonipat court, he will be killed in the same manner as the accused had killed his rival. So, keeping in view, a request was also made by accused in this regard for recording his statement under section 313 CRPC from Rohtak Jail. That application was allowed. He was, all the proceedings thereafter were held from, by after securing presence of accused from Rohtak Jail. And all the, not only the statement of accused, but even conviction as well as sentencing was passed online by securing the presence of accused from Rohtak Jail. And unfortunately, what I am trying to share with you is that unfortunately, now in April 2021, the accused who was sentenced by me to undergo life imprisonment and who was undergoing his life imprisonment at Rohtak Jail was shifted to Sonipat Jail in 2021. And unfortunately, after his transfer to Sonipat Jail in April 2021, he was killed by his rival gang in while he was in Sonipat Jail. So my point is that video conferencing is not always bad. It is not always detrimental to the rights of accused persons. Sometimes it saves accused persons. It is for the benefit of accused persons. It not only gives protection, it also provides speedy trial. The only requirement is application, implementation of fair trial principles. That is all. That is what we are supposed to do. If we are able to implement these fair trial principles, then even video conferencing proceedings are valid enough.
Yes, sir. So another question is that, and it's an important question that I also feel that, can identification of accused in session trial case through VC in jail by witness is legally allowed?
Yes, it is legally allowed. There is no bar to this. You see, virtual proceedings are equal to physical proceedings. If you go through the judgment of Honorable Supreme Court in state of Maharashtra versus Praful Desai, the court had specifically recorded, I'll read the words for you, that recording of evidence through video conferencing would be as per procedure established by law. So video conferencing has been accepted equivalent to physical courts. There is no bar to identify accused person in custody if it is done while securing by securing presence of accused through video conferencing. You kindly see in POXO Act, there is a specific provision for this. In POXO, the prosecutrix, minor prosecutrix, is rather protected not to face accused at the time of recording of her statement. I'm sure that in many courts now, video conferencing courts for POXO trials have already been constructed and working. One such court is available in Chandigarh, I have referred earlier also, where the prosecutrix can be examined through video conferencing, though available in the same courtroom proceedings and in the same courtroom, but in separate section, the accused can see and hear what she states, but the minor is unable to see and hear what accused says. So this is permissible. There is no bar to it. The only condition which has to be implemented is fair trial principles. They must be adopted. and no prejudice should be caused to the rights of accused.
Yes, sir. Sir, we have been receiving many questions, but we really don't have time left with us to take up all the questions. To my mind, as I have also been a keen listener to what sir was telling, that the answers to the questions we will find in the model rules of video conferencing, which were received by Honorable Supreme Court of India, along with the standard operating procedures which we had already received as formulated by sir only in the year 2013, as to how the coordinator is to be appointed, or how the evidence is to be recorded through VC, and how such cases will be dealt when one of the parties is residing abroad. So sir had touched upon all these aspects in his presentation. But if we really go through these model rules of video conferencing as we were provided last year in 2020, we shall be getting the answers. So here I would like to end our wonderful session that we are having. Thank you again, Pramod sir, for answering these questions and for the great presentation and enlightening us on this important aspect. It was a real pleasure to have you with us. And this concludes our webinar. Thank you all for attending this webinar, and I hope that we all have learned something and we enjoyed this presentation. Till we meet again with another topic, have a good day. Namaskar.
Thank you. Sure.